Thanks for having me today. Thanks in particular to Yusong and Hugo for inviting me to share our work. And thanks to everyone joining. It's nice to see some familiar faces and also some new ones. And it's an honor to be invited to share work with this group. I go by Josh. I'm Josh Gardner. I'm a PhD student at the University of Washington, and I'm also a student researcher on the Magenta team at Google, which explores the role of machine learning as a tool in the creative process. This talk will really focus on our work on multitask, multi-track music transcription. I know Ethan mentioned some pieces about this model maybe 2 weeks ago, my goal today is to sort of this will be pretty informal, but I really want to pull back the curtain to provide some detail on the task of automated music transcription, our approach to it, what worked and also what didn't, and kind of future work and challenges for the transcription space. Please feel free to interrupt me with questions at any point. I don't know if there's a chat, but it's really hard for me to monitor chats and things like this while also talking. So maybe if anything shows up in the chat, organizers, Hugo or Yusong, feel free to just interrupt me and I'm happy to answer questions as we go. Next slide. In this work, which is appearing at iClear 22, so in a few weeks, we present the first model to perform multitask, multi-track music transcription, and Yusong, if you can click twice here, which we call MT3. We perform transcription for an arbitrary set of instruments in a given input audio track. And I want to note from the outset that this is different from many prior automated music transcription works, which have mostly focused on hard coding sets of instruments and learning to transcribe only those instruments. For instance, that's how the Cerberus model that Ethan talked about a few weeks ago operates. It has individual heads for different instruments like guitar, bass, drums. MT3 uses a standard T5 small transformer architecture. It takes MEL spectrograms of audio as inputs, and it's trained simultaneously on a multi-dataset mixture, which is enabled by a shared flexible token vocabulary. This vocabulary, which I'll talk about in depth later on, is really the main technical advance of MT3 over prior transcription models. And it's what allows us to match or outperform these more dataset-specific models on every dataset we evaluate on. Next slide. Before I describe our model in detail, I kind of wanted to lead with a brief example of its results. So here in a second, Yusong will play this video and associated audio of a track. This is from the URMP dataset. And using MT3, we've transcribed the audio and resynthesized MT3's transcriptions using a standard software synthesizer. So in the video, it'll vary between the ground truth audio and our resynthesized transcription from MT3 as the clip plays. And so I think this track gives a nice demonstration of the task and also the data, which we'll dive into shortly. Yusong, maybe you can go ahead and play the clip and we'll just listen. We don't hear any audio, or at least I don't.
So you can hear the sound, right?
No.
Okay. Sorry. Then I have to. Okay. Let's try it again. Okay. We will go from the start.
So Yusong, we can click to the next slide. So this is just the outline for the rest of the talk. So first I want to really ground ourselves in the task. So what is automated music transcription and what's challenging about it? And what's our approach? We'll look in detail at the inputs and outputs to MT3. we'll talk a little bit about our training and evaluation setup, look in detail at some results, and then I'll give some reflections, like I said before, some of what didn't work, and then also talk about future work in this space, which I hope that many of the folks here are eager to take up. So next slide, and then one more. So let's talk about the task in detail. So formally, music transcription is the task of generating symbolic music representations from raw audio waveforms. And you want to note that audio is stored essentially as an extremely long sequence of floats, typically containing millions of samples for CD quality audio for just a few minutes of audio. So the goal is to obtain a representation similar to a piano roll, which includes detailed information about the pitch, timing, and instrument playing each note in the input audio. Next slide. So this task is challenging even under ideal circumstances with perfect data for several reasons. So songs can contain sets of instruments which vary widely across tracks. Think about the difference in instrumentation between an orchestral track and a jazz song, for example. Different instruments may sound similar. For example, viola, violin, and cello playing in different registers can be pretty difficult to disentangle. And the same instrument can sound different. So think about an electric guitar and the huge kind of sonic palette that just that one instrument might have. Instruments, of course, frequently overlap in the input audio. The music itself can take on a complex variety of timbres and patterns that make transcription difficult even for the best human experts. So on the right is an example of a 15-second clip of a track from the Slack dataset. So that's a spectrogram where the x-axis is the time dimension and the y-axis are male frequency bins. the color corresponds to the intensity of that frequency at that time point. And on the bottom is an example of the different tracks that MT3 transcribed from that input audio. So Yusung, if you just click, it'll label those. What I wanted to just get at here is another way to think about this task and why it's hard is that sort of the model needs to perform implicit source separation with instrument classification on top. And then finally, it needs to transcribe the notes from each instrument's source that it's separated out. So that means identifying the note, the onset, and the offset of each event in that piano roll for each instrument. And this is a relatively simple track in terms of maybe the number of notes and the number of tracks that are here. next slide. So compounding the challenge of music transcription in practice is the result that many existing transcription data sets are fairly small relative to maybe what we're used to in the applied machine learning world. Mostly this is due to copyright restrictions on the audio, as folks here are probably familiar with, but it's also labor intensive and expensive to annotate a multi-track recording. So this table shows some of the data sets used in our work. Note that all of the real audio data sets, so the ones that are not synthesized, except Maestro, are low resource. And I think this really highlights how useful of a contribution the existing data sets that we do have are, including things like MusicNet and the Slack data set, which Ethan put together. So in fact, some of the data sets used in this work here are so small that they've hardly ever even been treated seriously as transcription data sets. For example, URMP and GuitarSet are pretty rarely used in the transcription literature, which made even just finding baseline models for those data sets difficult. To other researchers, these were sort of so low resource that it may have seemed almost hopelessly difficult to try and train a transcription system using only one of these low resource data sets, which motivates the multitask training setup that we'll talk about later. Next slide. So another thing that makes this task challenging is that many of the prominent kind of real data transcription data sets include subtle and sometimes systematic transcription errors. So these are all different errors that we've observed in the data sets that we use in this work. And those include alignment errors, where, for example, the labels, the timing of the labels don't correspond to the timing of the audio. That could be either due to annotator error, or if you're using a score and the player, for example, doesn't play something exactly on time. Mislabeled instruments. So you might find a bass clarinet mislabeled as an oboe or a bassoon. There are missing or incorrect notes in some of these data sets. And also, we see things like octave errors, for example, in GuitarSet, because they use this hexaphonic pickup that has one pickup per string in the guitar. They automatically transcribe the strings from the hexaphonic pickup, and then humans edit it. But what happens sometimes with the hexaphonic pickup is it doesn't detect the fundamental, but it detects one octave up, and the human, if they don't correct it, ends up, leaving this octave error in the results, which you can see in several tracks in GuitarSet. So, like I said, we've observed all of these. Some of them can be systematic, and some can be sort of random, but just noise that make the task harder. Jeonwoo Kim has some nice examples of where he's identified some of these issues, visualizing them in MusicNet. And this on the right is a figure from the supplement of our paper where we tried to provide a little bit of insight into which data sets might contain timing errors by taking our trained model and varying the threshold that's used to detect whether the onset and offset of a note are correct or not. And you can see that the F1 score, using a given threshold, plateaus pretty quickly for all the data sets that are synthetic, which essentially have perfect alignment between the audio and the labels. But for the ones that involve a manual human annotation, there's more evidence potentially of timing errors as well. So this is another reason why transcription is hard, as anyone who took music lessons or maybe has done an actual music transcription already knows. Next slide. So next, we'll talk in detail here about the inputs and outputs to MT3. Next. So MT3 operates on approximately 2 second crops of log mel spectrograms. Each crop is handled independently, and we'll discuss the consequences of this later. The crop is fed into the model as a sequence of continuous valued frames. So I think if you click two times, Yusong. Yep, and then one more time. So this is what essentially the input for one frame might look like as the input to the encoder of MT3, where again the x-axis is the time dimension and the y-axis is the frequency dimension. And so these continuous input vectors are provided directly to the transformer encoder, which I'll talk about the architecture of later. Now we'll talk about the model outputs. This is really the key to MT3, is this flexible output vocabulary adapted to the music domain. Our vocabulary is what allows MT3 to learn to produce output sequences that describe the pitch and timing of notes from multiple instruments intertwined in a single stream. The representation that we use is general in the sense that these tokens can describe effectively any multi-instrument sequence of MIDI pitches, which is what allows for multi-dataset training. And recall that this is in contrast to many previous music transcription models, which mostly use architectures and loss functions specific to a single dataset or set of instruments. And the vocabulary is also flexible in the sense that additional tokens could be added to adapt the model through different kinds of output sequences or tasks. For example, we don't use velocity tokens, but you could easily add tokens representing velocity or other performance expressions, like maybe the equivalent of MIDI CC values to add more richness to the outputs. But all of that kind of fits into the same setup that we'll describe here. Click. So the sequence from the previous slide shows a possible output sequence of our model, where on the right is a sequence of color-coded tokens. We added spacing and coloring to make it easier to visually parse, but the way to read that sequence is from left to right, top to bottom, and that's how it would be output by MT3. We'll just use that sequence there to provide an overview of MT3's output vocabulary. On the left hand of this slide here, we have the different tokens in this vocabulary listed by category, and we'll just go through what those look like. If you're familiar with the MIDI protocol, this vocabulary is essentially, you know, a simplified version of what a MIDI message would actually look like. Click. So time tokens indicate the absolute time location of events in the current frame being processed, so in 10 millisecond increments. Again, note that the full frame size is fixed at around 2 seconds. So these place events within the time dimension of the output sequence. Click. Instrument or program number, as they're referred to in MIDI, tokens indicate to which instrument all of the following tokens apply until another instrument token occurs. Click. Note on off tokens indicate whether all following messages should start or stop the indicated notes. So this might allow you to, for example, play a two-note chord is what the first event is happening there. You can see that it has on, and then it has two notes that are being switched on, and then later those same notes get switched off. Click. Notes indicate the MIDI pitch of the note to be started or stopped. They go from 0 to 127, spanning the full range of MIDI notes and beyond actually the range of many instruments. Most instruments don't actually use that full range. Click. And so the remaining tokens in MT3's output vocabulary aren't represented in the sequence shown here, but they include 128 tokens dedicated to the 128 MIDI drum types. So if you're not familiar with the MIDI specification, if the program is drum, each note value, instead of being a pitch, refers to like one drum in the drum kit. So for example, snare, kick, a cowbell all have different notes for a drum program. And we also have a token to end what we call the tie section. And we describe that more in the paper, but essentially that's one trick that we use to overcome the limitation of the 2 second frames where the model is forced to declare whether it can hear notes being held over from the previous frame. So instead of say letting notes play forever that never get switched off, if it can't hear it or identify that it's still playing in the next frame, we just stop it. And it also helps avoid the model like stuttering and replaying notes at the beginning of every frame when they're really not, you know, new onsets, they're just continuations of already you know, held notes or chords. And then there's a standard EOS end of sentence token in the vocabulary as well, which at decoding time is what tells us to stop generating events in the sequence. Maybe before I talk about training and evaluation, I just wanted to stop and see if there are any questions at this point. Cool, okay, let's keep going then. Next slide. Yeah, so some of our work is based on this previous Hawthorne et al. Paper in Izmir this fall, which took a similar approach, but only for single instrument transcription, so only for transcribing the Maestro data set. And kind of what's still sort of amazing in that paper and also this one is that we're essentially using a standard kind of off-the-shelf T5 small transformer. It has 6 attention heads and 8 layers and pretty standard architecture for a transformer. So the model is trained with cross-entropy loss on the output tokens, and we use greedy autoregressive decoding during training. So essentially, an input sequence is fed in. The output token with the highest predicted probability of occurring next is appended to the sequence, and the process repeats until an end-of-sequence token is produced. But, you know, end-to-end, this is essentially what MT3 is doing. Click. So we use a multitask training setup for MT3, as I kind of referenced earlier. And so essentially what this allows us to do is train on several data sets at once, in our case, 6 data sets at once. So Our theory was that multitask training would at least reduce some of the difficulties due to low resource or poorly aligned individual data sets, and our results, I think, bear that out. This approach really hasn't been used in prior transcription works, which, as I've said a few times, really rely on kind of tuning the architecture and the model or the loss function to one data set instead of training across data sets. But you know, with the kind of general vocabulary that MT3 has, it allows us to treat all of these data sets kind of within the same framework and train all on all of them at the same time. This also allows us to leverage a much larger training data set than would be possible using just the individual low resource data sets in particular, which leads to pretty significant training gains. It also presents the, you know, a part of that probably is that the model is not overfitting as much to the individual data sets or to potentially kind of systematic labeling errors. For example, the octave errors that you might see in guitar set wouldn't be present for the guitar tracks in Cerberus or Slack. And so the model would be less inclined to learn to produce those and might be biased a little bit more toward producing kind of correct transcriptions. If we can just go back, I just wanted to note too that, you know, we didn't invent this training setup. This is really similar to how different languages are used to train multilingual NLP models. For example, there's a paper called MT5, which is the multilingual T5, that takes a similar approach. But the key here is that it requires this shared vocabulary in order to enable that multitask training, which really, you know, wasn't possible when you have, say, only four heads and in a Cerberus model and they're dedicated to specific instruments. We needed a way to represent, you know, sort of all transcription data sets in a unified language or vocabulary. Yeah, next slide now. And I think if you just click twice. So we have these kind of six different data sets being fed as input to MT3, but there's still a question of how exactly we should sample from these different data sets at training time. What we know from the natural language processing literature is that kind of a major factor in handling these low resource data sets effectively is sampling properly from them. So if you just sample according to the size of the data sets, you still sort of are stuck with this really strong bias toward the much larger data sets. The model just gets to see these data sets that might only have, you know, 1 or 3 hours of audio, much less than it would see the bigger data sets. We use a temperature-based sampling strategy that effectively upsamples smaller data sets. So it samples observations from a data set proportional to the size of the data set to the power alpha, where alpha is some value less than one. And this is a plot with log axes on both scales here, but it shows what that looks like. So essentially what we're seeing is that as a data set becomes very, very large, the sampling probability sort of levels off for that data set if this wasn't a log scale. And what that means is it effectively, when we use this temperature-based sampling, it effectively upweights the samples from the very small data sets. So we use a value of alpha of 0.3, which is the kind of solid line in that plot, which is, you know, more strongly biased towards the smaller data sets. As you get closer to one is when the sampling would be in direct proportion to the data set size. And alpha of 0.3 is equivalent to what's used actually in the MT5 multilingual T5 paper as well. So we found that this sampling strategy was important and that it considerably improved the performance on the lower resource data sets while maintaining good performance on the high resource data sets, which really didn't suffer at all. Next. So just a note here, as we look at the results, several models only transcribe a single data set. So we'll compare kind of individually to different models, and a part of that is because they're only designed to transcribe one data set. But we really considered this benchmarking across, all six of the good transcription data sets that we could find. We consider that benchmarking contribution of MT3, where we're kind of showing here's the performance that this same set of model parameters was able to achieve across many data sets. The only reason that there's an asterisk by the guitar set for Manilow et al. There is, we note this in the paper, but the way that we transcribe with that one is we keep only the notes that model transcribed or outputs in its guitar head, and we discard any other notes. So for example, if it thinks it hears piano notes or bass notes for any of the tracks in guitar set, those notes will be discarded and won't be kind of counted against it. So this might be sort of an optimistic assessment of its transcription performance on guitar set if it is hearing other instruments in the guitar tracks. We also note in the paper that there really isn't a clear way to evaluate multi-instrument transcription models. A lot of the prior work essentially might average the F1 scores across different instruments, or might just ignore the instrument dimension and just count a note as correct if the onset, offset, and pitch are correct, regardless of which instrument is being predicted. But we really feel that as the field moves towards multi-instrument transcription, and as kind of the capabilities of modern machine learning allow us to do multi-instrument transcription, we need metrics that really measure the correctness of the instrument labels as well. So we will look at mostly a multi-instrument F1 score, where we use a normal mere eval F1 score, which counts a note as correct if the onset and offset are within a certain threshold of the ground truth onset offset. The pitch needs to be correct, but also the instrument label needs to be correct. And we also include some comparisons to a modern DSP-based transcription tool called Melodyne, which was actually the only one that we could find to transcribe URMP. So next. So let's talk a little bit about the results. We can click to the next slide. And then I think if you click one time, you saw. So MT3 is the first model to achieve state-of-the-art transcription performance across several of these multi-instrument data sets kind of simultaneously. So for all five of the data sets. Oh, I think somebody needs to mute. For all six of the data sets that we have here, we outperform the existing state-of-the-art or we match it. And note that higher is better for the metrics shown here. So this is the onset offset F1 in the top table here, because many of these, or some of these models, I should say, don't predict instrument labels. And so I also want to observe that by mixing data sets with our training approach, we achieve even better results for the low resource data sets, such as URMP and guitar set, for example. So there's only 1 and 3 hours of total audio in those data sets. So we might kind of be hit a ceiling of the performance that we can obtain, for example, in URMP when we train an MT3 model only on URMP. But when we mix it together with the other data sets, the performance improves a lot. The F1 score almost triples. That kind of makes sense. Hopefully the model is learning a generalizable kind of representation from other similar data sets, like maybe MusicNet, for example, which also contains similar instrumentations from any other tracks. So on the bottom, if you click again, Yusung, you can see that multi-instrument F1 score. We look at three different ways of categorizing the instruments according to flat, where we ignore essentially the MIDI program number labels, MIDI class, which is in the original MIDI specification, they allowed you to group the MIDI instruments, I think by 8 or by 12. So all the different guitar sounds will be counted as correct if it was any guitar without respect to, say, electric guitar versus overdriven guitar. And then full is the strictest, where we need to predict exactly the correct program number for a note for it to be correct. But you can see as you go from flat to full for MT3, the performance really doesn't decline, which suggests that, you know, once we account for instrument in addition to the notes, the instrument labels are actually quite good for the data sets that we have here. So the bottom table really shows that the model is learning to predict fine-grained instrument categories with high accuracy. We also do some experiments at zero-shot generalization, where essentially we leave one data set or a group of data sets out, and we look at how the model performs on that with only training on the other data sets, so where it's unseen. This is a extremely challenging setup, and we certainly haven't kind of cracked that nut yet, as you can see here, although there are some encouraging signs of life. So while the frame scores stay relatively reasonable, you can see that there's a significant degradation in the multi-instrument F1 scores, the bottom kind of strip of that table, which suggests that the model isn't kind of fully learning generalizable representations of audio from the various data sets, and instead it might just be learning each data set at the same time, but sort of not in a generalizable way, but just overfitting six times to six different data sets as it trains, even during the multitask training. I think that this is kind of the next frontier for this type of model. And it's also interesting to think about maybe why certain data sets might have better zero-shot performance than others. For example, the MusicNet zero-shot performance here is actually the highest as a percentage of its non-zero-shot performance. We can note that the MT3 model, when it's trained only on MusicNet, achieves a multi-instrument F1 of 0.21. So what seems to be happening here might be that the quality of the MusicNet label alignment might be a factor, where it's overfitting to it in a MusicNet only model. When it only sees other data sets, maybe it overfits to that less and still gets decent transcription performance there. I would say something similar about GuitarSet and URMP, there are some other factors as well. For example, GuitarSet and Maestro are single instrument data sets that also happen to be pretty well represented in the other multi-instrument data sets. But I would consider this type of out-of-domain transcription generalization to be sort of the gold standard for when we have really solved the problem of multi-track, you know, music transcription. And we have encouraging signs of life towards that, but I definitely don't think the book is closed on that by MT3 yet. This was the point where I was going to click through some examples here and play them, but why don't we have Yusong do it? So we can maybe just listen to a couple of transcription examples from these different data sets to.
Yes, let me change my sharing. Quickly. So which tab I'm sharing?
Yes, we see the supplement. So I think what's interesting here, so we'll look at maybe a few of these transcription results maybe ultimate live demo experience. I'll even let Yusong pick some, but what we have on the left-hand side is the original audio. In the middle, we have what the ground truth transcription sounds like, and on the right-hand side, we have the resynthesized MT3 transcription. If you so desire, Yusong, you can hover over these plots and see the different notes. Actually, maybe you can't. I can't remember if these are JavaScript or just JPEGs. They are. So later, if you're interested to explore kind of some of the details of these transcriptions, you can. This is the supplemental example. the supplemental site to our paper. So maybe, Yusong, if we can play one example from Maestro, maybe the ground truth audio, and then the MT3 audio. Let's pick one with more notes. Maybe do you want to play the one, like two or three? So, you know, that's a single instrument data set. SLAC 2100 are 10 instrument mixes of stems from the SLAC data set. So these tend to be kind of much richer. Yeah, let's pick one of those and listen to the ground truth and the transcription as well. Yeah, maybe we can do one more. Let's play one for MusicNet or URMP, Yusong. So I think that gives a good example maybe of how things perform in domain. We also did some transcription of audio from in the wild. So not drawn from the training data sets, but just things that we pulled off of YouTube. And actually, Yusong, if you want to share back to the slides and the next slide, there's an example where before you click play, maybe I'll just kind of give the setup. So what we did was we took the audio from this video, we fed it into MT3 and transcribed it. We took MT3's transcription and synced it back up to the video. So you'll see people kind of performing, but you'll hear only the MT3 transcriptions. So yeah, let's maybe play a little bit of this. We won't play the whole thing. We can probably pause there. I think one thing that's funny about watching these videos too is you can hear the lack of velocity tokens, where it just looks like they're mashing every note on the piano, even when she's playing it very delicately. But only Maestro has reliable velocity annotations. So adding in kind of velocity is, I think, a limitation for some of these data sets. Maybe we can click through to the next slide. So I'll give a couple of reflections and then talk about future work, but I want to be conscious of time as well here. I'll try and go through these relatively quickly. So if you click one more time, Yusong, so on the top here, these are training curves for kind of our main mixture model during training on the individual data sets. The main thing that I want to draw your attention to here is sort of this interesting phenomenon that we observe consistently across sort of all of our training runs, which is on top, when I see some of these training curves, it looks like they're overfitting, where the loss is diverging after a short amount of time. And you might think, oh, we should kill those training runs. But on the bottom, if we look at not the validation loss, but the validation multi-instrument transcription F1, that continues to improve. I think this is sort of an interesting phenomenon. I don't know what the word for it is, but I think in practice, it's a good thing to be aware of, where the loss isn't improving, but the thing we care about, which is the transcription performance, the thing we arguably care about, the transcription performance still is. I think this is kind of a weird applied machine learning phenomenon that you know, gets left out of a paper, but was something that we observed and might be of interest to folks as kind of you're working on these music problems where you might care about some non-differentiable metric that actually continues to improve even when the model looks like it might not be. Click to the next slide. So another limitation of the model that I discussed earlier is it only has this limited context window. So we only get 2-second audio clips. They're transcribed individually, and with the exception of the tie section, they're essentially concatenated. There are some limitations of this, though, as you might imagine, and I think kind of future work, one area that we're really focusing on is how we can increase the context size beyond 2 seconds, or allow the model otherwise to have some kind of continuity in its predictions. In a second, Yusong, I'm going to ask you to play these two clips, but we'll hear a few things here that are in part a result of the model's limited context size. So you're going to hear this iconic bass line from a Herbie Hancock track, which sounds awesome. But then when you hear the model's transcription of it, you will actually hear it switch instruments almost exactly every 2 seconds. And that's kind of, due to the out of domain effect and also the fact that the synthesizer sound is sort of weird, but also due to the fact that the model doesn't know what it thought the instrument was 2 seconds ago, and it doesn't have any kind of continuity, despite being able to identify the pitch of the notes. So Yusong, I'll let you play maybe like 10 seconds of the original audio and then of the transcription, which is below. And then the drums come in, and then things just really get radical. So I think this is a limitation of our existing model. And like I said, it's a thing that we're working on. Yusong, if you want to skip 2 slides forward, maybe. So I'll skip over the domain gap piece, but maybe I just, oh, if we can go back one. There are also many things that we tried in this project that didn't work very well. Like I mentioned before, a lot of our work is inspired by these modern sequence models from natural language processing. So it was only natural to us to try some form of pre-training where we do T5 or BERT style span masking. So essentially you pick random spans in the time domain, you mask them out, and you force the model to fill in those spans of the spectrogram as a pre-training task. So there are 3 columns here. The leftmost column is just a set of input spectrograms. The middle column shows the masks that we generated when we were exploring pre-training. And in the right shows a very early model that has not converged yet, trying to fill in those spans. But essentially what we found when we did this is it really didn't help much. We saw limited benefits kind of early on from some of this pre-training when we were doing data set specific models, but when we shifted to multitask training, this pre-training really didn't make a difference. It could be that we didn't exactly find the right training setup. It's very likely, you know, that the kind of pre-training that would work well for an audio domain model is very different from the kind of pre-training that would work well from a language model, say, where you're just masking out words. It's actually pretty easy to fill in a spectrogram, even if you just look at, you know, you just look at it. This doesn't mean that some form of pre-training can't be helpful. In fact, this is something that we're actively still exploring, and we think we've, yeah, it's something that we're looking into. It didn't work, and so that's why we didn't include it, at least in this iteration of MT3. Click. So in general, kind of the future directions that I see for this work are kind of these. So similar to what other domains have been exploring, I think there's a lot of opportunity to leverage large unlabeled data sets for music transcription, maybe through new pre-training setups or heuristics that are maybe more appropriate to the domain of music and audio. Address some of the limitations of the model itself by increasing context size. So there are some several new kind of iterations of transformers that allow for much larger context windows, or doing just sliding window inference might be another way to take the existing model and try to ensure some continuity. Future work can close the loop. So not just transcribing audio, but also maybe allowing you to edit those transcriptions and then resynthesizing them with a paired synthesis model. So then you can go from audio to notes back to audio, similar to something like wave to MIDI to wave. You're saying you can click. And with that, you know, I wanted to say just thanks for joining the talk. There are some different resources here that you can check out if you're interested. So we have a blog about the paper and about the Maestro paper. There's the online supplement there, which is the page that Yusung was showing examples from. There's also an open source Colab demo where you can upload your own audio and have MT3 transcribe it. There was an unofficial Hugging Space, Hugging Face space set up for this as well by someone else, you know, by a third party. But I'm not sure if that's actually still working, but our Colab is. So please like go in, check it out, try it out. Please also feel free to reach out to myself or the other authors if you want to learn more or talk more about our work. Thanks for listening. I'm happy to answer any questions.